Hello, and welcome to the Paradox Podcast, the podcast about the business of the video games industry, and in part also about Paradox Interactive itself. This is a podcast where we try to shed a little bit more light on the inner workings of the games industry from a business perspective to make you understand why certain decisions are made and the processes that happen behind the scenes. This podcast is hosted by me, Shams Jorjani. I am the Chief Business Development Officer at Paradox, and my co-host, Daniel Goldberg, the Chief Marketing Officer at Paradox, is currently enjoying his paternity leave and will be back sometime next year. Sweden is currently experiencing a surge in COVID cases, so I'm doing my civic duty and I'm staying away from other humans, and I'm recording this episode solo. No Chewbacca will be joining me this time. So I might as well ask myself, strangely enough, what have I been playing? And the answer is nothing new, but a lot of old stuff. I've actually gone back and revisited a number of really great games to see how they've evolved over time. Games such as Civilization 6, Elite Dangerous, Destiny 2, EU4, Factorio, Sims 4, No Man's Sky, to name a few. All of these games are continuously developed, and all save for Destiny 2, I would say, are dedicated premium games. But they are supported much like live service games. So it's interesting to me to see where the effort is put in when development continues. As we know, no game is perfect. It approaches perfectness over time, but it never gets there. How the games look and feel when you boot them up, if the first-time user experience is better, how all the new additional content is presented, all of these are very different. Some games play and look and feel completely different, while others are virtually unchanged, and others feel like you're sitting in the same car, but it's been pimped up and it looks and it smells really great. So looking at what others are doing allows us to be smart about how we do our stuff, because at the end of the day, the games that Paradox make are meant to be endless. So we don't want to reinvent the wheel. We want to look at other pretty wheels and be inspired by the way they're doing their stuff. So with that, let's get the show on the road.
How much, quick?
What?
It's for the wife.
Oh, 20 shekels.
Right.
What?
There you are.
Wait a minute.
What?
Well, we're supposed to haggle.
No, I've got to get...
What do you mean, no?
I haven't got time.
Well, give it back then.
No, I just paid you.
What?
Yeah.
This bloke won't haggle.
Won't haggle?
All right.
Do we have to?
Now, look, I want 20 for that.
I just gave you
20. Now, are you telling me that's not worth 20 shekels?
No.
Look at it. For your equality, that's not...
We all do it. You do it. I do it. Your old neighbor does it. And all of your kids do it, for sure. Heck, even your mom does it. Everyone negotiates. And that's the topic of today's episode, negotiation. We don't claim to be negotiation experts here at Paradox. I certainly don't. But we have negotiated a lot over the years, and we've made many, many mistakes. And as we often say, mistakes are one of the good ways to learn and become better. About a year ago or so, a few things at Paradox prompted me and my colleague Magnus to make an effort to help raise the negotiation skills of Paradoxians. We realized that a lot of people in the organization were doing negotiations for the first time, and we couldn't participate in every single one of those negotiations and lend our experience. So we decided to put together something that would be able to help everyone at Paradox to kind of navigate the timeless art of negotiation a little bit better. We sat down, we brainstormed for a bit, we read up on the topic, and together with the whole business development team, we actually had a big workshop and we put together something that resulted in a nifty infographic that we then shared with the rest of the company. We've also then done kind of a small lecture circuit going around, visiting different teams at the company, talking about negotiation. And again, we're not experts, but we think that others can learn from our mistakes. So today's episode is me sharing the contents of the infographic. We will be posting it together with this episode in social media. So you can grab it, read it, print it, and put it up on the wall next to the picture of Margaret Thatcher or whoever else you have up there. So a bit of structure to this podcast first. I'm going to go over some of the do's and then I'm going to go over some of the don'ts. Then I'm going to talk about negotiation in stages, what to do before the negotiation, during, and after. That's the rough approach that we have to this. Okay, with that said, let's get going, essentially. So at Paradox, folks are likely negotiating a deal with a contractor, maybe getting a juicy upfront payment from a partner, hello Microsoft, a new game project, or you just are trying to get finance to approve that expense report without the receipts. Pro tip, don't. Negotiations come and go in every size, and so far I've never encountered one where these ubiquitous principles didn't apply. So these are useful regardless of the situation you're in, and heck, I might have used a couple of these with my kid once or twice. So without further ado, here are some of the most important do's for us when we negotiate at Paradox. Number one, we make sure that we fully understand, and I really mean as much as possible, understand the goals and priorities of ourselves. If we don't know where we want to end up, we should probably not get into the car. A good deal is not a goal defined. You have to have a very good understanding of exactly where you're headed. This is something you can't maybe define for yourself. You often have stakeholders, but make sure you fully understand exactly what the goals and priorities are. I can't stress this enough. Two, do this. Understand the counterpart. Do not negotiate in the dark. You have to find out what the other party prioritizes, values, and what they want to avoid. The more you know, the better. I'm going to use a Paradox classic to kind of drive this point home. We call it Fred's Orange Story, and I've asked my colleague Magnus to actually tell us the story. So let's listen. Okay, Magnus, how about the orange story? Can you tell that for us?
Absolutely. So the backdrop of this story is that it's something that our dear chairman used to share when he was the CEO of the company. And it goes like this. Two guys are fighting over 10 oranges, and they argue back and forth. You know, it's a bit of a trouble for both of these guys. One guy is saying that, you know, his needs are much greater, whereas the other one is very adamant and saying that, well, his needs are indeed much greater. So they end up killing each other, right? Which is a really bad outcome. So what did they do wrong here? Well, if they had asked each other what they actually wanted to do with oranges, they could have divided them up and gotten much more out of it. For instance, one guy might have wanted to make orange juice, you know, whereas the other one wanted marmalade. In this scenario, they could have divided them up and gotten much more out of this deal. So, Shams, what's the moral of the story here? What do you think?
Don't fight over oranges.
Well, that too, but I would say that the biggest one is, you know, always ask the big questions that you need to ask before you start a negotiation, and get to know the counterparty and his or her priorities. In this case, you know, in my experience, you can always find the win-win situations, and you can find, you know, a middle ground on several topics, because you know entering a negotiation that you will not get everything you want, but you know, you can find really what you prioritize and what the other one prioritizes.
Now, I'm sure a bunch of you marmalade nerds are going to come out of the woodworks and claim that that's not how you make marmalade. But you know what? Screw you and your marmalade. It's a good story, and I think you get the point. Moving on. So taking a cue from the orange story, let's continue. Here's another do that we strongly encourage everyone at Paradox to do. Always try to look for mutual gains, preferably long-term. Like Magnus said, you probably won't see eye to eye on everything. Start by focusing on the things that you do share. Mutual incentives are really, really great. It's the great lubricator of the business, as I call it. Nobody else does, but that's what I call it. So focusing on those and looking at long-term what you can gain together. Once you have a foothold there, you can kind of move on to the more trickier parts where there is no agreement. Number four, we tend to tell people to build smart bridges. And what do we mean by smart bridges? Inevitably, like I said, there will be gaps between you and the other party, and they should preferably be bridged using some kind of objective criteria. And what I mean by this is that there will be cases where just there is no consensus to be had. It'll often come down to it depends or we don't know. In these kind of cases, embracing the unknown and trying to discuss actual underlying metrics will allow us to kind of navigate this field out. Instead of talking about it depends, well, let that situation be resolved by how things perform. If things go in your favor, maybe what you're arguing should have the upper hand. And if they are right, maybe they should have the upper hand. So you can build that into whatever negotiation you're looking into. Number 5 is a classic when it comes to any negotiation. It's the good old good cop, bad cop. Saying, hey, my hands are tied. I want to give you a better deal, but my boss is a pain. It is a bit of a controversial thing, but as long as you don't do it dishonestly, it's actually a useful mechanic to use in a negotiation. And why? It removes the personal factor from the equation. It creates some kind of outside boundary and framework within which you can kind of operate. Being able to blame someone else actually allows both parties to more focus on the things at hand and set some of the trickier things apart. Number 6, smart anchoring. Actual science shows that being first to a position is actually best. By stating your position first, it actually anchors the negotiation closer to your position. Just don't go nuts and turn it into a Monty Python skit by starting stupidly low. I also like this because it allows you, puts you firmly in the driver's seat and you're driving the negotiation rather than having it happen to you. So being an active participant is good. Finally, the 7th do is to walk away. You do not want to close a deal at any cost. So never be afraid to walk away, even from a good deal. I think a rule of thumb is never get into a negotiation that you can't back out of. So those are generally speaking 7 high-level do's that we recommend people stick to whenever they start up a negotiation. On the other side, we have a number of don'ts. In part, they're the opposite of the do's, but I think it's still worthwhile to kind of explore them and see what we can learn from them anyway. The first one is avoid getting entrenched in positions. It's inefficient, it's painful, and it leads you astray. And by entrenched positions is starting to argue over a term for the sake of the term instead of understanding the underlying factors. And I'll give you an example. It's used many times in different books to describe this as a problem. It's usually called positional negotiation, and it's really bad. As the story goes, in 1961, nuclear peace talks failed because the Soviet Union and the US couldn't agree over the number of nuclear inspections. I think one party wanted 3, the other party wanted 10, and they couldn't quite agree. That was the entrenched positions that each party had. The problem was that nobody really took the time to define what an inspection would actually mean, at which point they might have realized that 3 or 10 might have been enough, and they could have moved past that impasse. So this is generally, if you get stuck in a position, move away from that position and don't get too locked down into it. The second one is really hard, and it's don't get emotional. Try to separate the people from the problems. It's really hard to do. We're at the end of the day, we're humans with emotions, but we have to stay cool. We have to stay Vulcan and have to keep these things separate. I've seen many negotiations go astray due to the lack of personal chemistry between the negotiators over the facts at hand. And we've got to remember, we're often negotiating partnerships, meaning we'll have to work with these people. So halfway through the negotiation, if the chemistry isn't there, you start asking yourself, is this really the person I want to work with? Is this culture clash going to lead to other problems? It is really hard, but try to keep these things separate and don't be influenced by your frustration with the lack of progress or whatever it might be at hand that's not going your way. The third don't is that information is power, and don't overshare. And remember Obi-Wan's from a certain point of view quote. So what do I actually mean by this? I'm saying that, yes, sharing too much information isn't necessarily a great thing. But relating back to what I spoke about earlier, being open and frank about your own long-term goals and intentions and priorities are good. But remember, that's you being a good negotiation partner. That's slightly different things. Being too much information without context might, especially with inexperienced negotiators, lead them to drawing erroneous conclusions on your behalf. This information depends obviously on the context which is being presented. But I've been in many negotiations where the other party is trying to cover every single angle that Paradox has in the situation, and they're trying to set stuff up, special rules to cover all of that, those edge cases, and it generally leads astray. To further dig down, ask yourself, do you really need to be specific with some of the information you're sharing, or do you want to generalize and talk about what you want to achieve in broad strokes? Maybe it's enough that you talk about your expectations rather than talk about exactly how great your margins would become with certain terms. Number four, don't be a Richard. You aren't negotiating with adversaries. Remember this, you're negotiating with future partners. So you don't want to burn bridges and set your colleagues up for a tougher spot down the line. At the end of the day, you're negotiating this and probably handing it over to other people involved, and thus you don't want to set them up in a tough spot. Number five, should not come as a surprise to anyone who's been following Paradox. Don't act and think short term. It only sets us up for failure in the long term. This is how we run our business, but also in negotiation, this is a good, solid advice. So you're not led astray. By the same token, number six, don't rush a negotiation. This is how mistakes are made. Sometimes things are, of course, time sensitive, happens all the time, but that's when it matters. And it's really important that you make sure that you know what your priorities and goals are. That actually allows you to do a negotiation faster. So that kind of summarizes some of the do's and some of the don'ts when you're approaching a negotiation. But in so many ways, the most important thing is make sure you know what you want and try to understand what the other parties really want as well. Businessman and entrepreneur Eli Broad once said, the best move you can make in a negotiation is to think of an incentive that the other person hasn't even thought of and then meet it. I think that's a pretty good pointer and kind of summarizes some of the stuff that we need here. Now, let's bring this home and talk about what to do in the different stages of negotiation and repeat some things in practical terms. Before the negotiation, I want to outline three things to bear in mind before you approach the negotiation. One, we've covered this before, know their positions and priorities. Know their priorities, what's a win to them, what do they want to avoid. The more you ask, the more you know. Same goes for you and your stakeholders. This is something you have to start with. My personal biggest screw-ups come from not doing enough prep work with the board or key stakeholders first. So really making sure you know all of the priorities and goals beforehand is absolutely key. Another thing you need to do before you start thinking of a negotiation is to know when to say no. Some of the best negotiations are actually the ones that end before they get started. Make sure you ask the big, hairy questions early on and figure out if this is worth pursuing. We often talk about getting to a fast no. A fast no is 100 times better than a slow maybe, both for them, both for you. Don't fool yourself thinking, I'll deal with this sensitive topic later. So grab the bull by the horns and try to get to those things right away. This is the most important stuff. And again, you can't do this without knowing what your priorities are. I think the third big important thing to do before heading into a negotiation is to set expectations. Help guide the other party by setting expectations of what the process will be like, what the timeline is, what your goals are, and what the reasonable outcomes are. And this will allow you to frame the upcoming negotiation. And when I'm talking about negotiation is that you'll be getting into this dance of a lot of back and forth. So before you get into that big back and forth, you have to do these kind of three things. As you can probably can tell, all of these three are mostly there to set yourself up and the other party for success during the negotiation. So once you get going, there are a few things to bear in mind during the negotiation dance. Keep it simple, stupid. That's what we say, KISS. If possible, do not overcomplicate the deal structure with a million ifs, ands, and buts. Rely on solid, measurable results as arbiters of gaps you need to bridge. Inexperience with contracts and negotiations usually show pretty clearly here. I've dealt with many indie developers that try to cover all the angles, and I talked about this before. Don't try to min-max the deal instead of getting the basics right. The basics actually matter more than a lot of the edge cases. You can deal with those edge cases later, but if your foundation isn't solid enough, you're in a world of hurt. During the negotiation, another thing is really important to keep focusing on those goals that we talked about. Remember what the key priorities are. You're definitely going to end up in a situation where you're going to start moving positions back and forth, and that's when knowing what you are ready to drop as non-essential terms and what you're not willing to move, such as key terms, is really, really important. The final important thing to keep in mind while you're doing this kind of negotiation is to kind of adapt, improvise, and overcome. Whenever you hit an impasse, take a step back and try to look for other angles. This is where having access to a lot of info is helpful. Maybe sometimes also it's pretty useful just to take a step back and see how things change, if the positions on the board change thanks to just waiting things out. And again, this is where it helps to have a bit of time and not starting the negotiation with your back against the wall. Okay, so those are the key things to think about during the negotiation. So you made it to the end, you got a draft of the contract. It's mostly okay, but it ain't over yet. Finally comes the closing phase, and this is where you shouldn't relax. So the first kind of thing we tell people is to remember that it's not over until the ink is dry. The deal is almost done, but it's not actually done until the contract is signed. Getting a signature sounds painfully silly to have to say, but it happens quite often that people actually focus so much on the negotiation that they forget to get the paperwork signed, and they start working according to what was agreed, and then things change, because as soon as you start development or whatever it is, things do change, and suddenly you have a contract that's not there and you agreed on other things. So it can get very messy. Don't forget to actually make sure it's signed as soon as possible. The second thing to remember during the closing phase is also to make sure that your counterpart completely understands your agreement and the wording reflects what you've actually agreed upon. This is something that's crucial for the poor people you'll be handing this project off to once you're done. You don't want to be the guy or girl where people go, what the hell were they thinking a year later when somebody actually bothers to read the contract? So this is to make sure that what you said was actually where you ended up. And again, to a lot of people, this is going to sound like duh, but trust me, this happens more often than you would believe. Coming back to making a lot of mistakes. So finally, and this is more of an emotional one, it's really important to actually end the negotiation on a high note for the most part. The final impression is the lasting impression, in part because that's probably your, as a business developer, whoever you are, involvement in the thing. It's a small world at the end of the day. You're probably going to have to deal with this person again in the future. Make sure you end on a high note and give the project or whatever it is the best start to kind of continue. That's kind of it. Every negotiation is different, so you can't apply this wholesale. But in broad strokes, this is how we approach negotiations at Paradox. We try to sanity check and use each other as sounding boards as often as possible to avoid myopia. It's very possible as a business developer to develop Stockholm syndrome and feel that you're being held hostage by the other party, the contract, or the deal itself, and you have to navigate all the different stakeholders. My biggest and most embarrassing mistake during negotiation is reneging on basic terms that we agreed upon in the 11th hour. This is super embarrassing. It's not something you want to do, and that's the result of not doing proper legwork in the beginning to make sure that all the stakeholders got their 2 cents in before you went to do the business tango. And that's the gist of it for this somewhat shorter episode. I hope it shed a little bit more light on some of the inner workings of how we do things. If I would summarize Paradox approach to when it comes to negotiation is that while we're not maybe the best in the world at negotiating, we're pretty actually good at prioritizing and knowing what we do compromise with and what we won't. For For further reading, we generally only recommend the book Getting to Yes by Roger Fisher and William Urey. There are a lot of other books, and they're probably fine as well, but we found that that one is pretty digestible and covers most of the bases. And it does rhyme pretty well with the culture that we have. There's probably, you know, a bunch of books out there about how to become alpha at negotiation, but that's not how we do it. So please let us know what you thought about the episode. Subscribe, hit that like button. If you have any questions or just want to air grievances, you'll find me on Twitter at ShamsterJohnny. And that is also where I'll be posting the negotiation infographic so you can put it up on your wall. Until then, stay safe, stay sane, and play some games. Bye.